Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So welcome, everybody. So it's this room is obviously too big for our group, I suppose. So it's my pleasure to welcome here Sonja Schlossmann from Centre Théorique Lumini, Physique Théorique Lumini, and the Institute for Information Transmission Problems in Moscow, which is a famous institute. I even know its name in Russian. And Sonja works in mathematical physics, as we all know, but he will talk about something which is perhaps a little bit more appropriate to the circumstances. And and the title is here, so it's Dynamics of Highly Connected Queuing Networks.
So I'm very happy to talk here, and we can use this occasion to really, I can try to explain all things which are there to explain, so ask questions, and I would be more than happy to answer. So that project originated years ago, and Roland Abruschen was, in fact, very interested in that. And what I'm going to talk about is a conjecture which is partly due to him about, and the idea was to, well, in this Information Transmission Institute, people were supposed to do something which is useful for applications. And so that is why, like here, yes. So, and so he was looking into queuing networks, and his idea was to apply method of statistical mechanics to study them in case when those networks are really huge, and so you cannot follow the details of every single client or server, and so then you want to develop some technique which is of the type of statistical mechanical approach that you don't look for for a specific locations, nor for a big system. You immediately go to the infinite volume limit and you try to build a theory there, and it is something like that that he also was advocating that one should do for the networks. And this is one aspect of that activity. So what I'm going to explain to you I will present a very simple model of queuing network, and it is more likely to be called an interacting particle system, so the simplest version of the queuing network, and so I will explain to you what exactly which particle system I mean. And then I will tell you which networks we are able to consider. Those are graphs of a mean field type. I will explain what that is. Then I tell you about the conjecture, this Poisson conjecture, which at some point was expected to hold universally, but in fact it is not the case. So there are some interesting counterexamples to that, which can be interpreted as one set of some kind of phase transition in those networks, and this is what I think is most interesting aspect of that work. So I will tell you about when that Poisson conjecture is valid and when it is not valid. I will give you an example of that, and then I say a few words about proofs, and there are some interesting and nice objects appear, and I will also explain what they are as we come closer to them. And the results that I'm going to talk about are obtained in collaboration with Alexander Rybko and Alexander Vladimirov, both from Moscow. And they can be found in the archive. We have like 5 papers on that subject. So what we are going to talk about, imagine some. So I will not be extremely specific maybe in the very beginning, but as we proceed, I will be more and more precise. So now it is a little bit vague. So we have some graph, and we think about the vertices of it as servers, and then we have clients which are served at those nodes. So they, as you see, they make queues, and then some of those are already on the service, and you see the clients of various kinds. The color represents their sort, and so every client is served for exponential time, but the rate at which it is served is a function of its color. So they have different waiting time. They spend different time at the server, and what happens after the service of one client, say that green client was served. So first of all, it changes its color. It now becomes a client of different sort, and then he chooses one of the possible channels to go to the next service, and once that happened, the server is looking in the queue, and he's picking up the next client who has to be served. That depends, so they have some priorities. So this pink one was chosen to be served next, and then what happens is that this client, which was green, now is served there at this node, and this pink one started to be served here. And this is what will happen in our system. Nobody enters in and nobody goes out, so it's they spend all their life queuing a different, so it's perfect bureaucratic arrangement. So okay, so this is particles, interacting particle system that we want to study.
So the clients don't have a choice to go.
They have a choice.
Not necessarily to any server they want. But
they
get forwarded by the server to another.
No, this is not the case. So after he knows where he wants to go, there might be several servers which are fine for him. Mm-hmm. So like imagine all those three would be okay. And then he makes a random choice where to go. Mm-hmm. And it arrives there, and he's going.
But some servers don't allow you to go to others.
Right. On that picture, yes, in principle. But this will not be the case in what follows. But in principle, that can be, right. Okay. And now let me tell you in which regime we want to study those questions. So we want to go to the infinite volume regime, which means that the number of nodes would diverge. We also would like to have the situation that the number of connections, to incoming and outgoing connections, is also increases with them, as well as the number of clients. So all of that goes to diverges, and we want to study the system in that regime. So we think that the number of clients is proportional to the number of nodes, and then let me explain to you what one should expect here, and this is expectation is what is called this Poisson hypothesis behavior. So first of all, what we want to do is the following: we take very large network, we put particles there, and by doing that, the situation is already started, and then we want to know what will happen with time. Well, one thing we should not do is to put, say, all of the clients to the same server, because then the queue would be very long, and so it will take enormous time just to dissolve. And this we are not interested in, so reasonable state means that we take some bounded, all the queues are bounded. We start with that, and then we want to know what will happen. Okay, so the first thing to expect is the following. See, at every node we have many, many input channels, and only few would be used, which means that along every channel the probability that the client would arrive is very small, and we have many of those, which means, all that would add up, we would expect to see something which has a Poisson flow behavior. Mm-hmm. And, And so it will then be governed by some rate function, lambda of t. This lambda, since we have several kinds of clients, that there are different lambdas for different sorts of clients and for different nodes. And then we expect that as time goes by, all those rates would go to their limiting constant values. And moreover, that convergence is uniform over the size of our network. So those three points is the meaning of the Poisson hypothesis behavior. So, right. We measure just locally. We want that at every location, we will find system already close to equilibrium. So, in other words, one can say that all that means that a network like I described, with many connections, hugely connected, that system cannot have any kind of memory. So, no matter what configuration you start with, because there are so many ways for clients to move, very soon it will forget the initial state, and this is what is called Poisson conjecture, Poisson hypothesis. And in fact, that was in the literature for many years to the leading way to make some estimation on the networks. Because if all that is true, then those limiting values of the rates you can compute just by knowing balance. And then you know more or less everything about your network after some time.
So the fact that you go to an equilibrium, I mean, there has to be a source of randomness, which is in this choice of...
Yes, exactly. Well, there is it's one, and then the service time itself is random. Mm-hmm. So that all that randomness...
Independent for each customer.
Right. So this is the expectation. So this is what is called Poisson hypothesis, and indeed there are instances when indeed this is true, and some in which I will be able to explain you why how it can break down. But first, let me tell you what networks we are going to talk about, and those I will call mean field graphs. And this is the following: take your favorite graph, they say, like this triangle here, then take a second copy of it and just put it nearby, and then what you should do next is to interconnect the vertices in such a way. See, that vertex here was connected to here and to this one, those two, but at this second copy there are also its cousins here. So now you not only go to here or to there, you also go to those same vertices in the second copy of your graph. So you do it like this. If you just start with one point, say with a loop, then you get a complete graph. But if you do things like that, then you get something more. Then you get other highly connected graphs. And those are the graphs we will talk about. And then you add the third copy and you connect them like that. And those are the networks that we will talk about. Now there are a few cases I will mention when this Poisson hypothesis holds. So the first one would be when we have just one type of clients. And the reason why it holds there is because of this self-averaging property that such a system would have. I just briefly mentioned it here. So the reason is that this self-averaging relation holds in that situation. And what does it mean is the following. So imagine we have some server, and this is the rate, a lambda is the rate at which Poisson clients are coming to it, and B is the rate at which they are going out. And it so happens that there is this relation here. So here we have a convolution, as you see here. with some stochastic kernel, but this kernel itself depends on this function lambda, which is the input rate. And then what we want to do is to solve that equation for b equals lambda, because this is what one has to analyze in order to see whether or not Poisson conjecture holds. And the further thing to say is that when you solve that for b equals lambda, and you know some a priori estimates on that stochastic kernel, you can show that actually such a function has to go to a constant limit as t goes to infinity. And so this is one case when this Poisson conjecture holds, and this is true for any load. The second case, which looks even simpler, is when we have several type of clients, but the load is very low. That means that the clients are just do not see each other too often, and so there is no way any memory can be kept by the system. They just do not meet, almost no interaction, and so the system immediately forgets what you start this is it from, and so this is not also a surprising statement. And now I want to explain the example where this the memory does not go away when you go to the infinite system. And so now I am starting to construct that system which has this memory effect. And it will be constructed. So this is the elementary graph that I have to start with. And then I will construct a mean field graph with many nodes. And this elementary network works in the following way. So we have, as you see, the maybe I go to the next slide. So what happens there is, see, there are three nodes here, but this one is different from those two. At this node, the clients have they have just one sort here. And then after being served, the client has a choice either to go this way and become a blue client, or going that way and become a red client. If it goes to the left, then he is going to that node. They are queuing here, as you see. And then they go here, and they are queuing there. And then they return back, and they forget their color. And another option would be if some of those clients would go to the right, then it becomes a red client, and then he goes here, and then he serves here, and then goes back here. What I have not yet told you is there are certain privileges. So, namely, they are the following. The red clients are, have, the blue clients are first, they are more equal than the red clients here, so they are served first here, and the red clients are first served there. So in fact, this is a wrong picture. So it should be corrected in the following way. So that blue client has to wait, and instead the red one is going to be served first. And after that, so only when there are no red clients here, the blue clients are served here, and then they go this way. And here they have a priority, and then they go back, and they forget their kind. And okay, so this is the network of clients. And the last thing I have to tell you is what are the rates at which those clients are served. And here you have those rates, those numbers here. And you cannot see whether that choice of numbers is of any importance. But believe me, there is a reason to choose them in the way which is indicated on the blackboard. And
So these are jump rates.
Right, right. Well, that's the same. So the green, the yellow one sits here.
Waits for, until the first clock. And
waits, and the rate of the clock is 3 here. And then with probability 1/2 it goes this way, and probability 1/2 it goes that way. Here they are very fast, as you see. The rate is 10, and then they go back with the rate 2. Okay? And now, where those numbers are coming from. To tell you this, I first tell you what do I mean by fluid network. So imagine you have several glasses filled with green water, okay? And those glasses are connected by tubes, and there are some pumps sitting at every tube, and they pump the water, and so you fill the glasses with water, and the engines are starting working, and then the level of the water is going to change in time. And what happens that what happens in fact that after some time the levels would get to some stationary values and will not change anymore. So after a finite time, the levels would not change, though the water would flow, but the input and the output would be the same, and so the levels would be constant. So the stationary regime of such a network is only constant level of liquids. So to get something more interesting, one has to consider fluid system with several fluids. And you see here this fluid system comes from the network that I was talking about, except now those are just the rates of the engines that we have on the tubes. See? So and here what happens is, you see, in this glass the blue liquid is more heavier than the pink one, so it goes to the bottom, and so it occupies. So that liquid here cannot flow because of it is this one is blocked here, and the blue one goes up here and become naturally yellow there, and only when that liquid would not be here anymore, this pink one would be able to go this way, and then he drops down this second glass. See, because this one again is heavier, so it is going down to the bottom, and then travels this way, and the blue one then is blocked here. Okay, so this is a fluid system with several fluids, and what is nice about this one is that this one already has periodic behavior. It does not, it doesn't have a stationary state. If you start from some interesting configuration, then in fact it periodically evolves and it never stops. And here how it goes. So if you put this blue liquid here, then it goes this way and it becomes, see, dark blue here, and then this dark blue liquid here goes here, and then here it is branches into two, right? So this blue liquid here, it goes out at rate 10, but comes in at rate only 3 over 2, which means that the overall level here goes down. But this pink one cannot leave that glass because the blue one is at the bottom. And so that would go for a while until that liquid here would actually no more be there. And that then we arrive to such a picture. And then if you look carefully, you see that this liquid here goes out at rate 2, but enters in only at rate 3 over 2 by this way, which means that the blue liquid also, the level also goes down. So after a while, we will find ourselves in that situation. But this is the same as that, except that now we have pink liquid. Now all the liquid is pink and is sitting in the glass. So this is half of the cycle. So after one of the second half, we are back to that picture, and so that fluid model really displays cyclic behavior, and this is why. And that behavior is the reason for everything else that I will tell you. Okay, now...
I didn't understand one thing. It's because as this...
Yep.
As this blue, when I look at it down the bottom...
Here?
Yeah, even if I keep pumping the... You know, even I pump the blue liquid at rate 10... But I keep pumping it out at rate 2.
see, this is all correct, but so this is the rate at which this pump is working, but it cannot pump more than is there. Yes. So this glass would stay always empty because the capacity of going out is 10 and the input is only 3 over 2. So all which enters go this way, but it does not, but the overall flow from that tube would be only 3 over 2. So most of the capacity of that one is just used for producing heat and nothing else. Okay? And now we could go back to the network, to the construction of the network. So see this is one version of that network, and I put here another one, the same one, except the cues are different. And then we apply now we interconnect the two networks in the following way. So just now the client can go not only on the big triangle, but at the very moment he also can choose to go into this inner one, and then maybe this way, and then maybe that way. So we put more and more triangles like that, and we get a network which satisfies all what we needed. So the number of clients is going to increase, the number of nodes going to infinity. Every node has about as many connections as the total number of nodes in that system. And then the result is that let us take this network, and let's take the size of it very large, and then let us consider some initial state such that at every node we have not more than some constant of clients. And then what happens is that if the load in the system, the number of clients, is not very high, then indeed the system relax to its equilibrium. This is just a Markov process, so there is nothing very special about it. So that Markov process goes to equilibrium in time, which is independent on the size of the system. And the second part of the statement is that if the number of clients per server is large enough, then the relaxation time of that system would diverge with the size of the system. And this is a manifestation of the phase transition, which happens in that situation. And one can say more about that. Namely, one can sit at a given few locations and look what the observer would see there when the size of the system goes to infinity. So in a finite situation, we are talking about just some marginals of Markov process, and one cannot say much about them. But when you take the limit, when the size of the system goes to infinity, then the resulting process you can study, it makes sense. And what you would see would not be a Markov process, but is something which is called nonlinear Markov process. And this nonlinear Markov process, this random process, is not ergodic when the load of the system, then this constant rho, is big enough. Okay, so so I can say that for high load, the behavior of the system is more or less similar to that dynamical system that I was talking about, except you have to take many versions of that system and couple those many dynamical systems together. I will say a few more words about that. But before, let me explain to you what those words, nonlinear Markov process, means. So if you just go back to refresh your memory about what the linear Markov chain is, then this is the following object. To define it, we need to know the transition, the matrix of transition probabilities. And this matrix is acting on the set of all probability measures on the set of configurations of this Markov chain in such a way that if we are in some state of Markov chain and then we apply this transition matrix, then this is the rule how we recover the state at the next time step of the chain. And the point here, and the word linear here is stays because the resulting map here is a fine map on this on that simplex. But and the non-linear Markov processes, if you want to talk about the situation for the just chain, discrete time chains, is the following situation: that we have again the set of the possible states of our random process, and then every such state comes with its own transition matrix. And if this is the case, then this is the rule how we go from one state to the state at the next time moment. We just take the state mu and we apply to it its own transition matrix, and this is the state of our process at the next time step, and this map is clearly nonlinear, and this is not such a popular subject because this is that definition is too general to produce any meaningful, nice, interesting theory. But yet, this is the object which would appear here in our setting. And this is a general feature of the mean field models. I believe it is more or less always that kind of random processes that you see here. So in our situation, this here you see the rates of the transition rates. So now our nonlinear process would be living on five-dimensional lattice. We have three nodes, and we have two nodes with two kinds of clients and one node with just one kind of client. So totally we have five-dimensional vector. And I was not introducing those notations. So this is the number of clients at the top node, and then those, okay, and the other are at the bottom four nodes. And those are the rates to jump. And as you see here I always have minus one, which means that this is only half of the jumps to go from some value to one value less. And this looks like ordinary rates, but there is the second half of the picture, namely what would happen if at some Q the number of clients increases by one. You should not try to understand all that here, but just look here, for example. Here you see the rate of that jump is given by a constant times something which depends on our measure nu. So we are in the state nu, and we want to know what are the rates to go to a new state. And the rates are computed, and in the computation, the measure itself enters. And so this is the random process that we have to study in order to understand the limiting behavior of our network. And the way to study that process is to go to a limit, you do the Euler scaling, and you send the load of your system to infinity. And then you make the usual Euler time change, and then you arrive to some new object. So by just taking that limit, so we increase the number of clients, but then we shorten the time it takes for every client to be served. And in that way, this Markov process becomes, this process of client serving becomes actually a fluid model, because every client now needs only infinitesimal time to be served. And this is why in that limit what we are getting is a fluid model, which is a dynamical system, but again it is not just a linear dynamical system, but something which should be called non-linear dynamical system. But again, not in the usual way that people are calling some dynamical system non-linear. But exactly here what happens is the following. So if you just take some dynamical classical dynamical system, which means that you say on Rn you have some vector field, and that vector field produces for you flow, and then the measures are carried by that flow in a natural way, And that flow is a linear transformation on the set of measures on Rn. But what we will get in our case would be a nonlinear dynamical system, which means that, again, it has to be defined immediately on the space of the measures on Rn. Namely, you should think about the situation when every measure comes with its own vector field. So you have a measure, then you have a vector field, then you move a little bit your measure along its vector field, and then you get a new measure, and that new measure has its own vector field, and this is the way how it proceeds. And this is exactly what will happen for the limiting fluid network, which is a collection of infinitely many dynamical systems, but coupled dynamical systems. Namely, again, we do the same trick as we did with the Markov process. Namely, we take two identical fluid models, and then we interconnect them in the Milfield manner. So now the fluid from here can not only can go here, but it also can move this way. And so we add on that picture four more connections, and then you do the same for other nodes, and you will get such a picture which you cannot even follow probably. But okay, so here that liquid was able to travel this way, but now it can also decide to go this way. And so this is how it can mix itself. And then you have to study that infinite dynamical system. And this is a nonlinear dynamical system. And namely, again, if we have a measure on five-dimensional space, then that measure travels along its own vector field. And this vector field is written here. So see, it is five-dimensional vector. And that part of the vector is constant, does not depend on your measure. And this second half, this other five-dimensional vector, in that vector, the measure mu enters explicitly, as you see. So every measure comes with its own vector field, and it goes along that vector. And we need to understand that dynamical system. And so what happens is that one can show that this infinite dimensional dynamical system also has a cycle. Which is analog of the cycle that I was telling you before. And this cycle is a stable attractor, so, which means that if you start your dynamical system nearby, then you are always staying near that cycle. And then you have to understand what that has to do with the initial Markov process. And the relation is the following. So you start now your Markov process with a measure like that. Well, how can you then say what happens with that, with your Markov process after some time t? Well, you apply to your Markov process the fluid dynamics. The fluid dynamics then makes it closer to the cycle. And you know also that the Markov process is not that far from the fluid dynamic along a given time set, time segment. Okay, which means that more or less that condition is reproduced. So you start from here. Because of that, this delta might become delta over 2. Because of fluctuation, it might grow up, but maybe not that much, which means that you are still close to the cycle. And this is how this fluid network helps you to understand the Markov process at high load. And so in this way, you prove then the theorem about this Markov process at high load. And to conclude, I would like to say that, in fact, we think that one can do some other system which are not anymore on mean field graphs, but one can do what is called Katz interaction procedure, which means that you take, say, a lattice, and then you connect every site to all the sites at distance, say, R capital. So which means that from every node, you have many, many R to the D connections. But this is not a complete graph, nor a mean field graph. And when this R is big enough, one can hope that the construction that I described would also hold in this lattice situation. But to have this transition that I was talking about, my understanding is that you should start with a lattice of dimension at least 3, because here you have, in a sense, breaking of continuous symmetry situation. This circle, the group of time shift, it acts here in a periodic manner. So in order to be able to have this transition, to have this several phases, my understanding is that you have to play that game with the Katz interaction on lattice of dimension at least 3. And then I think that one can recover the results I was talking about here for that other lattice as well. So this is the end. So I was faster than I...
It seems to me that the description of the dynamical, using the dynamical system, that, you know, that should work even for smaller logs, right? I mean, you're making it explicit only in the limit
the true statement is that this Markov process resembles the dynamical system only when you have very many particles. Otherwise, when you have one particle per 100 servers, there is no fluid. You don't see any fluid structure there. Particles are not, this is gas, I should probably say. Then they are traveling free, they don't see each other, they never met, so it has nothing to do with the fluid liquid at low level. So the fluid picture, this picture only becomes fluid when you have many particles at every glass, then the situation liquidifies. And otherwise, when they are not interacting, when they are not waiting for each other, you don't see any trace of fluid system. This dynamical system is always there, but you don't see its feature for low load. It forgets its memory.
Right,
in
so the dynamical
fine
system itself does not exhibit the breaking of the symmetry.
Well, the symmetry is always there, but it has nothing to do for the initial Markov process. That symmetry is valid for that Markov process only when the load becomes high. So you just do not see this cycle that you see. You believe that your Markov process behaves like that cycle. This, if that would be the case, then you can hope for the phase transition. But at low load, nothing like that happens with your Markov process. I would not. Well, the fluid system behaves. The fluid system, in a sense, has no parameters. It is just one given fluid system, and it has transition. This density, well, the Markov, the interacting particle system becomes the fluid system in the limit when the load in the particle system goes to infinity. So there is some dynamical system, and your Markov process goes to the dynamical system, which has symmetry when the load is high. When the load is low, you are very far away from the dynamical system, which behaves no matter which load you have. But for low load, it has, the dynamical system has nothing to do with the particle system. So once it becomes connected, then the Markov process exhibits that kind of behavior. Thank you for the attention.